We know that homosexuality is a sin. We know that it's an abomination. We know that it's something that God does not want us to do. However, we also know that pornography and, you know, looking at the internet sites that have pornography, imagining your past relationships, those are sins too. Those are hidden sins. People don't know about them. But if somebody is a homosexual, practicing homosexual, everybody knows about it. So their sin becomes one that people just grit their teeth and get angry over, as compared to somebody into pornography or even into child, what are they called? People who have sex with children, whatever they're called, pedophiles. What I'm saying is there are a lot of sins that are obvious and the whole world gets on people about them, and then there are sins that are hidden. One sin is not worse than the other sin. It's just that one sin is obvious. So my question to you is, can a homosexual be saved? And my answer to you is yes. Let me ask you this question. Can somebody who lies be saved? Yes. Can somebody who is continuing to lie still be saved? Yes. Can somebody who is looking at pornography be saved and continue to be saved? Yes. Just because their sin is not obvious and a homosexual sin is obvious does not mean they're not saved. In other words, what I'm telling you is all these things grieve the Holy Spirit. All these things are an abomination to the Holy Spirit. All these things are not part of your new nature. But everybody is at a different place and a different level in their life. Somebody can be a Christian for 20 years and be practicing homosexuality because they are a baby Christian and they don't know who they are in Christ. Someone can be 50 years be a Christian and being getting into pornography for the last year. They're still a Christian. They're still saved. All these sins might get you to heaven a whole lot faster because sin always brings death. It'll bring death in your relationship with your spouse. It'll bring death in relationship with your children. It will bring death with your body because your body knows when you're doing something wrong, and it will bring sickness onto you because it's feeling guilty, okay? Condemnation, sin, shame and guilt will come upon you. But does that mean they're not saved? No, that does not mean they're saved. They're still saved. Look at you. Okay, you who are snarling right now and angry because I'm saying this, what sins have you done today? Have you gossiped about your neighbor? Have you lied to your spouse? Have you lied to your children in order to not hurt their feelings? You're sinning too. Every day you're sinning. But your sins are not obvious. And the more mature you are and the more you're walking in the presence and the power of God, the less you're going to sin. The less of that old sin nature is going to come out. So those people who are outwardly sinning, who are saved and claim to be saved and are outwardly sinning, forgive them. Pray for them. Pray that they grow up in Jesus and they get to know who they are in Christ so that they have victory over the sin. Okay? Fornication, adultery. How many people are committing that? It doesn't mean just because somebody gets saved and 2 years later they go out and they're still single and they have sex, a one-night stand, or they have sex for a year or living with their girlfriend or boyfriend means they're going to hell. No, they're still saved. It's just they still don't know who they are in Christ. They still don't know the power that they have over sin. They're still living in their old nature. You need to pray for them. You need to give them my book. Get them to listen to my blogs. Get them to walk in power, to have victory. The reason Jesus saved us is so we would have victory over our sin. So we wouldn't continue to walk in it. Okay? So forgive those people and help them to grow strong in the Lord and mature and walk in everything that the blood of Jesus paid for them to have. So don't write me no nasty letters. I don't care what you say. I care what you say, but I'm not listening to it. I know that these people are saved. They're saved by the works of Jesus, by the obedience of Jesus and the blood of Jesus, not by what they do or don't do. As we continue our journey of sex and the Christian, let me share this also with you. Now, I already shared with you about people who are continuing to practice sin, whether they're saved or not. If God saved us when we were the worst and the worst of sinners, and now we're saved and we're still sinning doesn't mean we're going to hell. It just means we don't know who we are in Christ. Because he saved us when we're at our worst. Now that we're already saved, we need to become empowered. He's not going to leave us or desert us when we need him the most. He does not adopt us one day and unadopt us the next day. We're adopted. We're part of the family. Okay? Even the world system knows that. You don't adopt and unadopt your children. You love your children unconditionally. If your child goes to jail for murder, you're still going to love your child. If you're a good father or a good parent, you're still going to love your child. You're going to visit your child and jail, you're going to want the best for your child. You're going to pray for your child. God is the same way. He loves us unconditionally. There's only one sin that sends us to hell, and that's not receiving the gift that Jesus paid for, the price for all of our sins. So let's go on to the next step. How can we have, as a Christian, how can we have a satisfying relationship? Well, the number one thing that I would like to tell you is honest, open communication. Be who you are all the time. Now, what I mean when I say that is you don't go around and telling your spouse all his faults, because that's not love. You don't lie, but you find ways of building them up and speaking good, godly words over them. You don't tell them that they're weak or wimpy or that they just aren't the man or whatever. It's honest communication. In the sense of when you say this, I feel like this, or when this happens, this is how this makes me feel, or whatever. Not honest in communication. Well, you're a pig. You eat like a pig. You're not putting down. Okay, so honest, open communication, but walking in love. And the other thing I like to say is the Word of God has to be the foundation for everything in your life. Everything in your life. You have to realize that if your spouse dies tomorrow, if your spouse cheats on you tomorrow, if your spouse does whatever, the biggest shocker of all, that everything is between you and God. You and God. And you always have God in that relationship with Him. So you build that relationship with God, number one. Both of you have to build that relationship with God and make a firm foundation. And everything in your relationship should be based on that. And don't get married if your spouse is not believing the same things you believe, because that will cause a lot of tension and a lot of battles. Okay? So another piece of advice that I would give you is don't call your spouse your old man, your old lady. That is so disrespectful. Do not do that. Your spouse is valuable. And this is a pet peeve of mine, and I see this happen so much, and my husband and me never, ever, ever do this to each other. Don't ever put down your spouse in front of another person. Do not ever belittle your spouse in front of another person. If you have something to say to your spouse, say it later and say it in an uplifting manner. Do not put down your spouse in front of another person. And one thing that I always try to do in front of my husband is I try to praise him in front of other people, because he is an awesome, awesome man of God. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I let people know how wonderful my husband is in front of my husband. I honor him. I see God in him like no other man, and I value him, and I make sure people know that. And as the years go by, I value him more and more, and I see more and more treasures in him and enjoy more and more freedom. And I believe also, as you grow more and more mature in your marriage and time goes by, that your sex should be freer, that your communication about sex should be more open and more freer, and it should be more relaxed and more natural. So that is my advice to Christians and sex and marriage. And my name is RobinBremer.net is my website. I pray that you have a blessed day, a wonderful relationship with your spouse, and I'll talk to you tomorrow.